You got to speak on up.
I mean, I can't keep...
All the little funny little...
issues. Okay, but I didn't expect to be talking about children.
Huh?
I wasn't...
Well, I'm trying to get you to tell...
Why would
you,
I...
Well, you, well, this, are you ready to talk about genocide?
Yes.
Okay, listen, you're doing well. But I just want you to be more forceful. You're doing well. This genocide, you ready to deal with genocide?
Yes.
Okay, here we go. It's 10 minutes. Give me some study you studied about on this reference to this. You doing right. You doing all right. I just want to feel star performance. That's what this is all about. This is about stardom. Yeah. You ready?
Yes.
Wake up. Here you come. Get ready. We got 9 minutes and 50 seconds. Now you ready to knock it out here. Knock it out the ballpark. That's what you gotta do now. Here we go. Wake up, wake up. The camera's on you now. Thank you and welcome back to the final segment of the show for today. We're talking to Alana McLaughlin, and she's giving us some information in reference to world inhumanities and genocide. And of course, Alana led us doing this final segment, think in terms of genocide. I think that you have information in reference to that. And I think that in order to deal with inhumanities, we're talking about something that is terminal, which is to say there's one thing to fight one another and to have wars and et cetera, but genocide is a little different because the purpose of genocide is what? The complete eradication, I think, as you've mentioned, of a race. Let's talk about it from that perspective. Let's deal with genocide at this particular time.
Well, if you're just tuning in previous segments, I talked about what the difference between world inhumanities and genocide was. Genocide, like you said, is the eradication of an entire race by mass killing. For instance, the Rwandan genocide. If you're unfamiliar with the Rwandan genocide was when the Hutu government in Rwanda wanted to kill off the Tutsis and ended up killing from 100,000 to about 1 million Tutsis. And there's a whole movie about it, which is Hotel Rwanda, mm-hmm. which was a very popular movie, and that's how I found out about it. The biggest core difference between genocide and world inhumanities is basically perception, because not all the times that bad things happen can you actually ask the perpetrator, hey, why'd you do this? So if it looks like genocide, we're going to classify it as genocide. Mm-hmm. And if it doesn't, then it's just a world inhumanity. And I don't want to say just to kind of make it seem smaller than it is. It's still a great issue in the United States, and world inhumanities are way more frequent than genocide. Like I mentioned in the last segment, bullying is a world inhumanity, and you may not think it is because it's not great scale or all that, but it still is because it's teasing, taunting one another, hurting each other, and that's a world inhumanity. Another very famous form of genocide was in April 1992 in Bosnia. The Bosnian and Bosniak and Croatian genocide, where the Yugoslav army and Bosnian forces started to kill Bosniaks, which were Bosnian Muslims, and Croatian civilians. They killed about 100,000 of them, making it, and at the time, it was the worst genocide since the Holocaust, at the time. And so, that's another very popular form of genocide, but I think that the most popular form and one of the worst in the world was the Holocaust. If you're unfamiliar with the Holocaust, this is when Adolf Hitler, Nazi party leader, came to power in Europe and Germany and et cetera, and he ruled over all these places and he decided to kill off Jewish people. Now, what a lot of people fail to realize is that he did not only kill Jewish people. Most people just say that he killed off Jewish people because that's who he killed off the most of. That's who the main target, you know? Say if you're hunting and you want a deer, but you see rabbits and et cetera, you're gonna kill those as well. But the main target was Jewish people. He also killed gypsies and drifters and African Americans, lots of orphans, gay people. He killed anyone who wasn't his image of a perfect civilian, which was a blonde-haired, blue-eyed person with light skin. And so, if you weren't Adolf Hitler's image of beauty, you were sent to concentration camps, you were forced to do hard labor, you possibly could be killed on sight, you could be robbed, and all these horrible, horrible things. And I think a key question that you have to ask when dealing with genocide is why? Why did someone want to kill, why did the Hutu government want to kill all the Tutsis? Why did Adolf Hitler want to kill all the Jewish people? Why did the Yugoslav army and Bosnian forces want to kill off Bosniaks? It's all stemming from one key thing, which is hate. Hate breeds every evil thing in the world. If you talk about any world in humanity or genocide, look at the perpetrator and then think, he had to have hated this group of people that he was targeting or whoever to be able to do something like this, like the Trail of Tears. Andrew Jackson must have, I don't know if he hated them, and I can't really ask him now, but he had no sort of sympathetic feelings for the Native Americans, so he made them walk and he made them go out in the winter with no food and no clothing and et cetera. For the Holocaust, Adolf Hitler, now I can actually say, and he has been quoted as saying that he hated Jewish people, and that's why he did what he did, and it's not a justification by any means, but more of a reason why he did that. And so, I personally believe that a way that we can start to see a decrease in world inhumanities and genocides and killing is teach your children love before you teach them hate, and don't teach them hate at that. For instance, racism. Racism is not, you're not born racist, you're taught racism. In a lot of cases, a lot of 21st century racist teenagers and children were born into racist families. And so they see that growing up and they think that that's the right way to go, because your first role models are your parents and your family, and when you see them doing something, you're going to automatically assume that that's right. And when you hear otherwise, you want to fight with them because, no, my parents did it, those are my role models, and that's right. And so that's the key thing and a lot of this. And so many people would just say, oh, no, they're born to be da da da. That could have been changed by just simply teaching your children to love and be decent people.
Oh, so and Lana, so in your age group, do you find that there are many people who reflect upon some of the things that we're talking about now, about how they ought to feel toward one another, to enjoy and obey the golden rules, do unto others as you would have? Do you find much sentiment like that, or is it almost, as you've indicated on so many occasions, some kind of controversy or some kind of bullying or some kind of pushing or whatever? Is there any movement towards sanity in reference to man's relationship to man that you see in your everyday life? And if not, what can you tell your peers as to how they might make things better for everybody?
Speaking about my age group, sanity is a taboo. It is common that you see people laughing at other people's failures, at other people's mishaps, and that's what's become of social media. You can get on any teenager's social media page, you'll find some video of like someone falling over or somebody like getting hit with a ball or something, and see a million people laughing about it. Like, people's mishaps are hilarious to people, and I've been falling victim to this sometimes. Like, I saw this video of this kid getting hit with a ball. But anyway, it's just, being nice people is just, it's so rare. And it sometimes it even astounds me because I can laugh at, like, say a kid falling over. Like, if he doesn't get really injured, like, I can laugh at that. I can't laugh at someone getting hit by a car or falling off of bridges and stuff like that. And those are the types of videos that go viral that people sit and laugh at for days and days and days. And I'm like, wow, when did we, like, I knew this generation was bad, and I knew that we were very selfish and not selfless, but I didn't know that it was that bad. And so I just, like I said earlier, I'm going to reiterate on that. Teach your children to be nice to one another, because it'll go a long way.
Mm-hmm. And so, Lana, over the last minute that we have here, let me thank you for coming by with that very, very important information, because I think it gave us an opportunity to hear a perspective from a person who has been involved with a number of things and who really know quite a bit about what is going on among your peers. And so I think that that's quite helpful to us, and it's also encouraging when we can find that there are persons who are willing to think in terms of the greater good, and they are willing to go out and preach. And I think that that's one of the things that people can say about you in reference to your appearance on this show, is that you often come as a good role model. And I've heard people say in many instances dealing with you in reference to that. And I want to thank you for that. And let me encourage our audience to tune in again next week for another informative edition of Comments. Thank you and good morning.